Okay, hello everybody. I'm Matthias Borch, and this is my stream. This is my level retrospective that I decided I should do. And today is really just supposed to be a introduction stream. I only set up like this entire setup last night and a little bit today with the help of some people, which was awesome. And the idea was that I would go back and stream all of the levels that I've made over my career, and that kind of shaped me as a designer over the next few days, maybe over the Christmas break, seeing exactly when I'll have time, and and seeing how long that's going to take. So I can give you a little bit of introduction and give you an idea what the stream is supposed to be about. I'm mostly doing it for myself. I do want to upload it later and maybe put it on YouTube, but you know, it's probably mostly going to be for people who know me or people who have an idea I've worked with in the past or who come from the same kind of background that I've come from. So these days I'm a design director in the game design industry, and I work at a company called Hangar 13, which is a 2K studio. We just were announced like a few weeks ago. We haven't announced what we're working on yet, but you know, we're within 2K, making the kind of games that 2K I think is really good at and known for. But I've been a level designer pretty much for all my life, and I think this idea for doing this came out of doing my GDC talk, like Game Developers Conference talk this year, which was all about meaningful choice in game design, because a lot of this talk was a little bit of a retrospective and an introspective about how I believe games become engaging and fun. And I realized, well, for one, this talk then became a lot about Doom and Doom Deathmatch, and I realized that Doom had shaped me a lot in, you know, how I look at game design today. And I realized, so I talked about Doom and my level specifically in that talk, and I realized that as I'm going back through the last 16 years or so I've been doing this professionally, there's a whole bunch of different ways in which, you know, I grew, in which I became the designer I am today. Now, you know, maybe it's fun to go back and play all these levels and do a little bit of commentary, just play them, rediscover them, because I haven't played a lot of this stuff, and just see what kind of comes out of my brain as I'm doing this. So the idea is that I'm going to try to keep these streams to about an hour, which means in my mind, and I have no idea if this is going to be true, it's going to be about four levels or so, probably per stream. So I want to do Doom first. I want to play through the Trooper's Playground, which is my initial Doom episode, then go at Memento Mori and Requiem, maybe play some Deathmatch levels as well. But then the other games I've worked on that I want to go back to would be Sin, Wheel of Time, the Unreal Mission Pack, Unreal 2. I might be able to get some Rebel Strike, Star Wars Rogue Squadron Rebel Strike in here, but I'll have to figure out how I would capture that, because I don't have a card for it. But then, definitely, as I'm going forward, I want to end with Dead Space 2, which is the last game that I worked on officially as a level designer, which I think would be fun to go back to. The other reason I wanted to do this is because, well, everybody's using Twitch these days, right? But I've actually been watching quite a few Let's Play videos, just on and off of my old games and my old levels, and it's been quite a lot of fun to kind of get that perspective on, you know, how other people experience them. So even though you're playing, you know, working on this stuff, there's a lot of focus testing and there's a lot of outside perspective you're trying to get, especially these days. Like, a lot of the early games I worked on, we didn't really do it, which was a problem. But seeing people really play it out in the wild is really interesting, and seeing people experience it is really interesting. So I figured, you know, just doing this would be a nice little thing to do. So today I only want to play a single level. This is still kind of me trying to get my bearings and see if all of this works out, if I'm actually recording this correctly, if my setup is going to hold up and so on. So this is the very first Quake level that I ever really finished. This is called TTP Bonus. It wasn't good enough to be included in my Trooper's Playground collection, which I'm going to start with tomorrow, because it was the very first one and you're definitely going to see that. But I included it as a bonus, and for me this is like a really good level to just play today and kind of, you know, try all of this out. So without much further ado, I'm just going to play this, and I think the voice and, you know, the volume and all that stuff is going to work out pretty well. You guys tell me on the chat. I have like a little video over here. If like the mixing works correctly and you can get this correctly, and, you know, if not, that's, you know, I can always adjust it. And yeah, an entire Sin playthrough. I don't think I can do all of these games like sequentially for the entire game, so I think I'm going to focus on my levels, and then I might go to surrounding levels just to set it up. But yeah, even just going to my step back and remembering what it was like to work on those levels and remembering who else was working on them and so on, I think it's going to be interesting. So yeah, so this is TTP Bonus. I have no idea what I actually called it back then. Let's just play a little bit. I might die, by the way. I haven't played Doom for a while. I'm playing it in ultra-violence because that's the only way you play Doom. But this is on a laptop. I haven't done this in this kind of setup, so we'll see. I'm going to save every so often to make sure that as I'm going through this, I don't look too stupid. Now, let's see, so this is how it starts. No entrance, nothing right here. Just a couple of guys standing in front of you. And the thing you're going to notice very quickly, I played just a little bit of this earlier to make sure all of this worked. This level was just made kind of linearly without any sort of plan or any sort of, really thinking about it. Even the way it introduces itself, I mean, there's something to it. But as soon as you go into this level, into this room, for example, I noticed, you probably do not start the player out with only 8 shots of ammo. Like a Baron of Hell takes 10 shots from the single barrel shotgun and immediately throw one of these barons at you, because I'm not even going to have enough ammo to take this guy out. But especially back then, this is not the very first level I made just purely there's some test levels and stuff I made before, of course, but this is the first level that it actually was supposed to be a complete. I'm going to die here before I even can save. I don't think so, but this was really just made for me to play. I think some of my friends might have played this, but that was about it. Jesus, I am not hitting this guy very well, am I? See, the very first level I remember making was actually a Heretic level. Like, back then, I can go into a little bit more detail how I started playing Doom. I played Doom 1 and Doom 2, of course, but when I actually had a modem and I had access, I think there was a... Yeah, there's a secret here, and I think I have to go back here to actually open it. When I got a modem and I managed to log into Fidonet, as you might call it, I don't actually know what the American name for it would be. I remember this guy. Heretic was already out, and I downloaded Wadded, which is the editor I used back then. And I was playing a lot of Heretic with a neighbor at that point. Like, he brought over his computer all the time. We played, just hooked it up over a null modem cable. And so that's what I started making. It was just a single room, and I think then I started making this. I made, I think, one of the deathmatch levels that came with this. That's the very first one. The very first level I ever made, and then moved on to this one. So, there are two different ways to play this, I think. Oh, forgot about this. I think both of these ways are valid. Of course, I just locked myself in. But I think you can go around either way. But a lot of what you're gonna see here, for one, is like the lighting is non-existent. Even for Doom, right? You can do so much more with lighting. It just kind of sets values for each sector, and it's pretty much just a linear progression that you're gonna find. You can go both ways, and I think there's like a progression here where I need various keys, but beyond that it's just gonna kind of, I don't think there's a lot of backtracking, there's not a lot of going back and forth. So don't really even have a memory of exactly what I was thinking when I made this stuff. A lot of it, I think, again, was just trying out different elements. Something that I said in my GDC talk as well, what I really liked about making Doom levels is that as I started making these levels, I'd already played a lot of Doom. I'd played tons of single player as well as deathmatch. So I had a general... It's right here now. Hey look, I actually made some torches and a little bit of light effects here. So I already had a pretty good idea of how these games could play and what good level design should be, but of course this is me then exploring, putting all these elements together, like a whole bunch of imps behind a behind a fence like this. So I think this right here is gonna let me in there. Yep. Like, there's a whole game design lecture on affordance that I could hold about how we signified various like elevators and secret doors and having the player hunt for just parts of walls which are slightly off, where the texture is, looks slightly different and has a sign and so on, and how some of it is good, some of it is bad. But I don't think I'm going to do that right now. I am somewhat proud of me, because either this is a complete coincidence or I actually aligned these textures correctly. If you remember making Doom levels, all of these textures would come in like lower packed or upper packed, like they would always, on these kind of stairs, they would have a stepping effect as well, and you had to manually align them. They weren't even UVs, right? It was just the UV offset. But a lot of people, even a lot of the official levels, didn't do this, and this was one of the things that, you know, here you probably had to go in and then offset it correctly to make sure that this stair didn't look like a mess. So I'm kind of proud of myself for having done that back then. Now, let me save right here. Let's save over this. I'm somewhat suspect of exactly how... Oh, I think I remember what's back there. Somewhat suspect of all the acid here. I think I might die rather quickly. Now, let me... Oh, that's a cheap shot, really. Now, I'm probably not even going to find all of the secrets anymore, because I don't remember all of them. So there's a good chance that there might actually have been one of those sludge vest suits that you can use to go over acid or not, or waste. Maybe not. But I do believe, yes, that there was a... And what do you call this guy? Let's assume, or let's pretend I didn't immediately know he was here. Well, I kind of already did that. The guy who was spewing all the lost souls. I have to look up the name again, because I actually... I thought I knew all of them. But this is probably the first time I ever placed one in one of my levels and just kind of created a very rudimentary environment around him. If we go all the way back up here, just to... I think the way this was supposed to play out is that you kind of walk all the way down this path up there, seeing the red key, and then you want it, and you're wondering, well, should I run down here, or you take the side run path. I'm assuming that this right here, well, I'm not just assuming, it's my... Yeah, see, that's where affordance is actually pretty terrible. I'm using it both for secret doors, and I'm using it to show something as different and as life-saving as an elevator right there. So let's see what happens here. Okay, that's good. And then, not being able to see the floor there, that's pretty terrible, actually. So you don't know if you're actually standing on it or not. And then, okay, I'm just barely making my way back over here. Yay. So yeah, I think that's the entire side here. And then after you go through the red door, which I can do now, pretty much made it. But purely as a as a level design exercise, it's just very much... Not that I ever really changed that as I was making more amateur levels, but you can very clearly see how I'm just, you know, I'm just making stuff up as I'm going along. Might be quite a bit of cursing, actually. I already just called myself, or kept myself from saying the S-word. Just because growing up in Germany, I never really cared about all of these curse words. They just don't... There aren't really any taboo words in Germany. You know, there's nothing... No word that you can't say on TV and so on. So F-words and S-words and so on, they just don't quite have the same, like, meaning to me. So, we'll see. I'll try to keep it down, to keep this family-friendly. I think my wife and my kids are watching this right now, so I don't really want them to... get ideas, but I'm just warning everybody who might be watching this along, or might be watching this with kids. Yeah. Oh, this is terrible, because I'm picking up these... Oh, okay, I just have full ammo, I think that's why. But I remember that... I remember when I made this that there were a whole bunch of situations where these weapons would fall just exactly on the edge and you would have to go down onto the slime to pick them up and various shenanigans like that. I think I was proud of myself because this, I think, if you're remembering everything I've done up to this point, this is the first time actually doing something with floors, right? There's just a little bit of definition on the floor to make it more interesting. And if you look at the top there, the ceiling, hey, the lighting is slightly different. So I think this is me just experimenting with that. And it's probably the first time I ever did that. Something I do want to talk about quite a bit as we're talking about Doom, and I'll probably do this as we're going on in these streams, and maybe even take a timeout for 15 minutes or so to reference my GDC talk, is the enemy differentiation. And something that I think is incredibly well done in Doom, and one of the reasons why it's still such a popular game today, having different weapons that different weapons and enemies that can be prioritized, that the player can have an opinion on, depending on what exactly the setup is. Oh look, I think there's a key here. So yeah, just kind of came out of nowhere, didn't it? And being able to make decisions based on that. You don't really get that in this level design. In these spaces right here, and I certainly wasn't playing around with it. This is incredibly intuitive right there. But I think that's something to talk about. This just kind of steady diet of enemies right here. But that's something to dig into more deeply later on. Just kind of taking these guys out one by one. And Doom can do so much better. So I actually need health. I don't need more ammo. I'm totally full on ammo. The way I did all of my level balancing up to like all my amateur career was just the way I could play it. And I think it was always a little bit hardcore because I was ultimately a pretty advanced Doom player. But I never really... I had a couple of friends... What does this do? A couple of friends playtest every so often. But a lot of the ammo and health distribution in here was just purely on how I could play it back in the day. It's coming to back to haunt me all these years afterwards. In fact, just going back to this real quick, I actually found the... this was the readme that came with it, right? And apparently I made this... I released this, and I think I was trying to use American notation for the date. I think this was March 8, 96. And the reason why I think it must be that is perhaps a little bit clearer when we're talking about Requiem. Because I made a lot of Requiem levels while the Olympic Games were going on in Atlanta. In fact, I made one of those levels during the opening ceremony in Atlanta. And I think that must have been like July or August or so. So this must have come out just like a few months before that. And must have been in March. But yeah, it gives you an idea. So this is how old these levels are. there isn't much in here, of course. This was really just something that came as part of TTP. But yeah, so this is kind of biting me in the ass after all these years, right? Because Matthias back in 96 and how he could play the game, it's very different from Matthias today, who's running out of health more than ammo and would really like some of this back, because I don't know if I can survive this. Anyway, take a drink here. So I'm trying to remind myself to every so often look at the stream and maybe answer some questions right then. So one of the questions I saw is, did you design levels with control in mind? Because a lot of people played Doom with keyboard only back then. So yes and no, I wasn't really concerned with it. I pretty much only ever played Doom with the mouse and keyboard. And that really was a novelty back then. Now, I actually went through all different control schemes. In fact, I was very happy when at some point I got an analog joystick, like one of those flight simulation joysticks, and I thought, hey, finally I have the right input method to play Doom correctly. And of course, that was not at all true. I kept going back to using the mouse. But not really. I think that's one of the problems, right? The way I was able to play Doom and just how sophisticated I was with playing Doom. Now, you could argue that everybody who downloaded these levels was on the same sophistication level because they were die-hard, hardcore fans and who knew how to use a modem, but I would say that the way I was able to play this game was very far removed from a lot of other people who might have played this much more casually and might not have been able to play the game as well as possible. Going through these kind of hallways right here without a mouse, I mean, yes, you could probably do this. And there were some people who were incredibly good playing with a keyboard only, right? In fact, there were a bunch of deathmatchers back then who only used the keyboard and who handily beat me. So ultimately, the mouse won out because it gave you more control over it, but they were really good at it. So I think those people would have been able to play this very, very well. But a bunch of more casual players using the keyboard only, yeah, I don't know what this would have done to them. So let's go back and see what that... that's what it did. Because Matthias in 2014 did not actually know what that anonymous switch over there did. Which is a problem in general, and you know what, I mean, that's also a sign of the times. Just how much affordance and just how verbose we are about communicating what has happened. Back then, there were a lot of anonymous switches, anonymous doors, and so on. That, in fact, I mean, I looked a little bit into my one of my levels from Wheel of Time that I want to get to, and I realized just how bad as a level designer I was. And if there had been like a strong design leadership, if I'd been the lead designer on that, where I would have encouraged people to very much put a little bit of extra effort into communicating affordance on these things. But in these days, you just put anonymous switches everywhere, and you know, like in this case, there's no other way back. So there's a switch, you hear something, so at least there's a little bit of feedback, and then as you come back here, you realize, okay, that's what that did. But it's always after the fact, or very often. Cool, so can I open this again? Cool. I'm assuming I did not lose any, I did not leave any health behind here. Okay, well, it's not too bad though. You're doing okay. So now I think, and I'm trying to remember, I guess we'll see. I'm probably going to need the yellow key somewhere down here, right? In fact, can I see it from here? Okay, yeah, I can see it from, it's up here actually. So that's what I needed the yellow key for, and that's, I guess, how I can probably even open it from down here. Yeah, just doesn't help me because I can't get up there. But yeah, so I'm just trying to remember exactly what the level flow here was. And I could be wrong on this, but I'm pretty sure that Z-Doom actually added a whole bunch of the color coding in here, right? Where the yellow door and the red door is actually showing up as yellow and red, because otherwise I don't think back in Doom you were actually able to see this. So let's keep going. What's in here? Uh-oh. That actually, like the Revenant, because, you know, I'm pretty sure back then I had no idea, or, you know, I always knew he was there. But here he actually blends in very well with a whole bunch of the other dead bodies in here, and a bunch of the, like, that guy in the spike there and so on. I don't think there was an Archvile in this level, in fact, I'm pretty sure. But if there had not been, or in fact, if this was Dead Space 2, I would immediately imagine one of the Rejuvenator guys. That's not what we called them, but the guys who could come in and make zombies come in, because it's the perfect kind of setup for this. So, again, not to go too deeply into this, what I really like about Doom, because I see a Revenant here, and I actually have the choice in how I get to engage this guy. Well, it's perfect, because there's one weapon of these two, which is much better for it. And that is the minigun, right? The chain gun right here. Because I can actually keep this guy in pain chance, in actually pretty much impossible to shoot back at me, which, seeing how there's pretty much no cover anywhere here, it's probably going to be pretty good. Let's actually not do that. I'm going to run out of ammo almost anyway, and let's actually engage this guy a little bit more, the way most people probably would. Well, with a little bit more playtesting, I probably would have noticed that this staircase here was not perfect. Now, I'm trying to remember, I don't think this used any of my custom textures. I'm pretty sure this green marble floor was actually in the game. I think I might have made a, and I think we'll see this in actual TTP proper, I think I made a black and white version of it. Which just shows you how long I haven't played Doom anymore, and how I don't know the what perfectly anymore. Because I have to make these kind of assumptions. But yeah, I'm pretty damn sure that's what it was like. So it's kind of wasted space. Just one Revenant in here. And this is an Ultraviolet. Violent. Ultraviolet is a movie I've never watched, and a really bad movie scheme that I never actually use for my downloadable movies. Anyway. What's happening here? Oh, yes. Uh-oh, bad Matthias. That's not good. Let's see if I can survive this. Yeah, see. Great job, former me. So, you know what? I should actually try to take this guy out without using the minigun, because the machine gun. So I think I want to use that in that trap room. I think what just happened there, I mean, that's not good level design, right? That, again, is a sign of me just trying out a whole bunch of stuff. In fact, and I'd have to go into the actual level to check the sector numbers. One of the things that I really like about Doom levels is that because each sector is numbered, you can actually go back and after the fact track exactly how a level was made, just sequentially, because you can see which sector was made first and so on. I'm pretty sure as it went through it, it actually would be a very sequential, like, this is sector 1, it goes through here, this is probably everything, then I probably built everything in here, going all the way back, and I have to go all the way back, and then I probably built anything we just saw. And the way reason I'm saying that is because as you're looking at me getting more comfortable with stuff, this doesn't have any lighting whatsoever. You go into here and you start seeing some lighting. Just a little bit, sure, but even so. This is me trying out some various monster setups and enemy setups, and how I think this is probably the first time I actually did a chroma keyed like middle fence, because you had to do like a lower unpacked and upper unpacked, and this thing goes into the middle, and that's probably what I tried out here. And as I came back, or as we went through here, I probably get a little bit more adventurous with the floors right here. And then as I went down here, I want to say that, you know, not only trying out some more awesome lighting schemes, but I probably started working out movers a lot more, and I started making my first trap, which is, I would say, what this room is really all about, right? Because it's a trap and it's kind of unfair, but never mind that, I was just kind of trying out stuff, and created this situation then here, that I now have to, and I don't even know if the light comes back on or not. I think that was it, but yeah. That, well, I probably, oh, there you go. Oh, I think that's what it was. Yeah, there were like, I think there's a line death going right through the middle here, which turns it on and off. Or there's two, I think, like right in the middle. And depending on which one you cross over, it turns it on and off. And the idea was that, well, and it didn't really work out, right? Because the pinkies immediately come in and just kind of corner me. But I think the idea was that I sometimes get a glimpse of them and sometimes I don't. But yeah, so that's definitely something I would have done a little bit later then, as I got more adventurous. It's kind of cool as an idea, actually, now thinking back about it. But, you know, yeah, it didn't quite work out in gameplay terms. It's one of these cool ideas that don't mean anything unless they actually work when the player sees them. It's kind of cool to see it after the fact. Okay, so I hope nobody here has any sort of medical conditions where this is actually throwing them off. I like how the machine gunners have like this perfect sweet spot where if you get them perfectly with a single barrel shotgun, not good people. I didn't have any minigun left. Okay, let's do this again. But yeah, they have this perfect sweet spot where if you get them perfectly, you get them with a single shot. But you really have to try. Okay, let's do this. Again, this is a little bit of a dick move, putting these guys right here, because... again. I could have gotten that. I think that's me not playing very well, to be honest. Oh, see? Sweet spot missed. Trying to keep these... Oh, man. See, and I lost one of them. They get crushed and you lose them, so now I have less ammo left, which is terrible. Even just seeing these guys, how they are somewhat randomly showing up here. Should have won last time around. Like, all of this is just a little bit too variable. Not in the I want to dictate exactly how the level plays out, but purely looking out for the player kind of sense. There we go. Let me save again, because I'm not doing very well here. Right, and I think you want to guarantee a little bit more that players don't run into unfair situations where sometimes this is just much harder than other times. Okay, so let's keep going. There's so many shotgun shells that I could actually just try to take them out all the way from back here. Usually this is where I would say, you know what, this is where you entice to actually switch all the way back to the pistol and just try to take them out at a distance. But I have so much ammo, because it's not tuned that well. And it's kind of cool, I guess, in that I want the minigun or the chain gun more and more. Go in here. Take these guys out. There we are. And I also agree, somebody just on the stream kind of said, you know, I think that's what you're trying to say. You know, back then everything was more hardcore, and the people who played these levels generally were more tolerant of pain. Right, and certainly, like, this was for me and some friends when he downloaded this stuff. Yeah, you want it to be hardcore. I'm not really in the let's babysit or let's shelter players these days school of game design, but I do want things to be consistent and fair. That's really what it comes down to. And I think what we had just there wasn't quite consistent and fair for multiple reasons, and that could have been done better. I have no idea what this I mean, yeah, it's a kind of cool switch, but I have no idea what a switch is here. This does not make any sense. It does not at all fit, does it? Aha, infighting for the win. Oh, perfect. And now I get a whole bunch of... Oh, somebody's teleporting in. I think I know what that is. I get a whole bunch of machine guns again. So one thing I like, just as a general game design philosophy, is enemies as opportunities instead of just enemies as obstacles to go through. Because players, in my, at least in my mind, never are drawn to enemies. Enemies are always obstacles on the way of getting somewhere. And if you just put them in there and they do not afford you anything, you do not get anything out of them, they become less interesting because they do not represent an opportunity. I very much like having enemies, enemies which contain various game mechanics or just actually resources. Being able to take somebody down and then get a good weapon out of them, or being able to replenish on ammo or so, that's something that's cool. So right here, even though these guys weren't that difficult, there's like a certain twinge of satisfaction that comes out of that, right? Because you took these guys out and now I've refilled on minigun ammo, which chain gun ammo, which I didn't have a lot. So that must be a secret, right? Kind of badly designed secret, because it's one of those, well, these guys are coming up, but one of those moments where you cannot look up and down, and somewhat unfair to go all the way down here. And, I mean, and this is really bad, you could just see it here, but the fact that you're coming in here and you can barely see what you're actually getting, which is this armor, yeah, I mean, this is all stuff I would never let pass these days. But, and again, I want to say this, because this did not happen automatically, and I mean, that's a little bit of meticulousness, which I think every good level designer should have. All of these textures are perfectly aligned, and that took some work. And, you know, there were level designers who did this, and level designers who didn't do this. And I'm kind of proud of myself of the fact that I actually did it back then. In fact, it even wraps all the way around here, all the way around here. So that's pretty awesome. There's also a reason why I don't think I could line it up down here at the step. So, yay, Matthias in 96. That was good. Once again here, like all those guys, they all spawned in, it's impossible to pretty much deal with them. Let me, and what's even worse, oh my god, I was just enticed to jump down there to deal with them without actually hitting that switch, and I would have to come all the way back. Let's do the switch first, and then go down here. Because, I mean, ultimately it's a shortcoming of the Doom engine, or more specifically, it's a shortcoming of I think John Carmack not wanting to do up and down, right? Because he could do it, I think, in Heretic and the games that Raven did, but Carmack didn't feel like, because it skewed the view, it was 2.5D, it wasn't real D, and it made it look bad, so he couldn't do it in Doom games. But not being able to look up and down, I think the level designer then very much has the task of making sure that they accommodate those shortcomings in the engine, and I'm not necessarily doing a good job of that right here. Anyway, so far so good. So I think there's one more section to this, and I think this literally, the way we've played it now, somewhat accidentally, is exactly the way I played the level, built the level back then. And if you're looking at this, there's not much here, right? It's actually a very uncomplicated level. That's kind of interesting how that worked out. Now the one thing I was going to mention, that this level actually did have inspiration. There was some influences on this. And it was, and I maybe go into this a little deeper, this was actually based on an environment from a children's book series that I used to read back then. And there's some history behind it. So the series is called Burg Schreckenstein, which is this boarding school which happens, it's in Germany, right? It's all in German. It's a boarding school, or kind of a boarding school, that's on an old castle. And all the boys there, it's like for 10 to 14 year olds. And all the boys who are getting there actually learn that they call themselves knights, like the old knights there, and, you know, like are very honorable, and so on and so on. But the way that that environment was described, well, there's actually two things, but the way that that castle was described had very specific influence onto the deathmatch map that I made for this, and a little bit of influence for this as well. And at some point they go into a Scottish castle. They have like an exchange program, and they're surprising these boys at a Scottish castle. And it's called like Dunquake, I believe. And that castle has a very specific layout as well described. And everything going down here was especially influenced by that. Because it has kind of a dungeon kind of area where you can go down all the way to the ocean. And there's like an old boat there where the old Scottish like seamen like went into sea and so on. But so I remember that this was specifically influenced by that. Now, the reason why I think all of this came into my mind, and I was actually influenced by this, because when I made this, this was 1996, so I was 20 at that point, is because the very first environment, 3D environment I ever made, was made in the 3D construction kit. Some of you guys might remember this, right? Like Castle Master, and Driller, and those kind of games, Incentive. They made 3D, like, vector flat-shaded games back then, and at some point they released the entire engine, and it was called 3D Construction Kit. I got it for the Amiga. I spent all of my allowance on it for like 170 Deutsche Mark, which was, I mean, it was a lot for me. But so this must have been in 91, maybe 92, probably 91, very close to when I actually read this book series. And at that point, the very first environment I made was to recreate that entire school in intricate detail, as much as you could, you know, in a really simple, flat-shaded environment. I recreated all of Burg Schreckenstein in that engine. So when I came back to this, and I'm making 3D environments again, all of this is on my mind, and it's influencing the way, you know, especially as I'm just kind of going ahead and making stuff up, I think all of that influenced me. And yeah, that's how all this happened, and that's why this right here, even though you would not be able to see it, I'm pretty sure, I mean, I have to tell you right here, but you know, where you have kind of a spiral staircase right here going down, and I'm pretty sure, like, the rooms that we have down there, there's going to be some water there where you can look out into the ocean, I think. It's like in the book, I think that's where their classrooms are, like makeshift classrooms are in there. that's how all this came to be. And I love those little personal stories, because ultimately as a level designer going back, I find that through entire career, there's always a memory, one or two memories attached to how you made certain levels and what was going on in your life. It might be a specific music CD you were listening to at that point. It might be a book, or just, you know, the influence that... Look, there's actually a little BSP error right here. You probably can't see it on the screen because I think it's too small. It's actually 1 pixel wide. But I love how all of these memories come back, and you can actually remember this, like 18 years later, 20 years later, for what's going on in your life. It very much, like, gets baked into your brain. Is this? Yes, it is. I'm feeling clever and good about myself. So whenever there is a memory of just what was going on or what I remembered, I'll try to point that out in streams later on. Let me look at the stream, at the chat real quick. So just to remember, this is Suebuil. This is the very first Doom map ever finished. And I do want to do this entire stream as a retrospective of all levels that I made, either amateur or professionally. So I want to do all my Doom levels first. I'm going to do a Trooper's Playground, then I'm going to do Memento Mori and Requiem. Then I want to go to my Quake levels, all of that. You know, that's ultimately what got me into the industry. And then I started making games professionally, so I want to look at my Sin levels, my Unreal Mission Pack levels, Wheel of Time, Unreal 2, Dead Space 2, and maybe some stuff in between as well. So yeah, this is me just kind of reminiscing, or however you say that, and just going back to all of this stuff. That's the idea behind this, yep. Now these tight hallways once again. I think I was kind of enamored with organic shapes at that point, because you saw it a little bit. Well, can't see it right now because I can't easily do it on the screen. But yeah, I think I was just looking into how to do line depths and actually set these sectors in something that resembled a organic or at least non-square shape. Now again, this is terrible design, right? I mean, I am completely wasting the Baron of Hell here. Should probably be a Hell Knight anyway. Maybe it is on a lower difficulty level. I'd have to go back, but I can't really strafe around this guy. I don't get any differentiation between these people. There's no prioritization because I don't see a lineup of multiple enemies and I get to prioritize who I should shoot at first. It's pretty badly designed, but you know, that's all the things that you learn as you start making levels more and more. And as I mentioned earlier, I do want to talk about this more as I'm going on and I look at more Doom levels. Can I get this guy? No, he's still alive. So yeah. I can try to click on this link that ZGamer just sent out. Now, I'm putting my chat on my iPad strip app. And yeah. Oh, that's the... That does look somewhat similar. You're 100% correct. That picture looks somewhat similar to those textures. Interesting. So let's see, am I still on the stream? I think this still works, but let me check. So yeah, I think this still works. Cool. Okay, let's keep going. So, what I mentioned earlier, I finally get the double-barreled shotgun. So, you know, there's a little bit of progression in here. So, this is what I mentioned earlier, you know. This is probably where the ship, the Viking ship, would have gone, or whatever. And, this is where you would look out into the ocean, and so on. And then this here would actually be those classrooms from the book. Again, it's something that you would not at all know, of course. And everything is pretty... Everything about this map is completely anonymous, right? I mean... You could only do so much in Doom levels in the first place. In fact, I believe that trying to do too much literal storytelling and trying to build very precise or real-world spaces in Doom was always fraught with peril. You were always abstract, like in your tech environments and so on, but this was, even for what you could do with Doom, was incredibly limited, of course. So I think there's a secret here. It's not even a secret, I think it's a way to get to the mancubus here. But certainly my slapdash level design of just like creating rooms and then putting various enemies in here continuous. You can probably see that again. This is the first time I ever put one of these mini spiders in here. This is the first time I ever put a mancubus in anything. Alright, so what does this do? It opened a door somewhere. I don't even remember where. We shall find out. Oh, did this open that door? Maybe? No, maybe it actually... opened this door. I don't know. I'd have to go back. Somebody might actually know my own level better and could go back and actually verify exactly what happened and didn't happen. Save one more time and drink a little bit. Yeah, so as we go on and we play some of the later levels, I'm hoping that purely on a level design standpoint, it's going to be more fun just watching me play those levels because, you know, they're better level design. This, of course, is just very... What's this for? I don't even know. Is Doom your favorite game, Matthias? It's one of them. It's probably one of three. I just saw this on the chat, by the way. I'm reading this. So the three games that I think really shaped me as a game designer or just as a gamer are pretty distinct. And of course, there's tons of games that I played all the time. But if I'm looking at my design sensibilities, Doom is one of them. Because everything I know about level design and 3D level design and meaningful choice and so on, I feel that I learned... by playing Doom and making Doom levels. And again, like, there's much more detail in my GDC talk, for example. I can't go into that. But so that's one of them. The other one is Turrican, because I played that game all the time on the Amiga. Like, I spent entire... You know how people do, like, mega play sessions and they play through all of Final Fantasy, or used to, probably still do, in one weekend or so, like 40 hours straight? Well, I used to just play through Turrican 2 specifically all the time. So, I never really made a game, that's not true. I actually worked on a version of Turrican when I was at Factor 5 that never saw the light of day. So, I actually tried to make a game like that. But yeah. The second game. The third game would be Ultima. Ultima specifically, as a open world sensibility, as a... like kind of teaching me non-linear game design and really allowing the player to chart their own journey, not trying to spoon-feed things, allowing the player to piece things together, creating an open world, creating a breathing world, creating something that just exists even though the player isn't there, would be the third one. So those three games I think I would certainly put on my list. I would also put Pools of Darkness on there, because I played that all the time, and again I think there's a lot of game design lessons in there, the way that the combat worked out in there. And probably a whole bunch of other ones, but yeah, so that's how Doom is up there. I would actually put Dead Space 2 on that list. I would probably put Wheel of Time on that list. We'll look at both of those, give you an idea. But yeah, so how are you actually supposed to play this? I should probably actually pay a little bit of attention here. I don't know how to actually play this. This is how. Oh man, that is not good. That's bad. How are you even supposed to play this, Matt? Terrible. I don't know how. Fully ran into my own trap. Let's save. And I think we're pretty much done with this level now anyway. There can't be much more here as we keep going on. In fact, I think this is probably the last switch, and that's going to get me to the end of this level. Cool. I am up. I'm right here. Is this the end? Oh, and this is where... See, oh my god. Terrible level designer. I think... Yep. So the suit that I already used up there, and which didn't have any conceivable use, of course, is to get through this blood pool, and there's no way for me to actually deal with this. So, let's see if I can even do this. Yeah. So I pretty much screwed myself here. And I don't even know if I can recover from it. Those are the perils of making levels without playtesting them back then. Let's see if I can kind of recover from this by working around it. But I mean, that's just terrible game design, right? It's terrible level design, there's no discussion. Okay, well, I'm only at 18%, so it's probably not the best way to try to do this again. I'm wondering if I can... Oh god, this is just annoying. Terrible game designer. You know what, let me load again. And try to play this as optimized as humanly possible. To make it through here, because... I'm not going to be defeated by my own level. Okay, so let's save right here, even though this level has some pretty terrible design. And I'm not even sure how I'm supposed to deal with this guy. I mean, yeah, it's just bad. No discussion. And that's okay. Oops. Freaking myself out here, so I use this to go in here. Maybe do it like this. Now take this. Oh, of course he's gonna... As in, dynamic is actually kind of cool, right? He keeps reviving the guy I just killed in that stupid room, but... Oh, he killed you. Okay, we're good. I think I made it. If I don't get killed going through this... Let me save again, because I just did all of this. How am I... Oh, I think that's how. Yes, I made it. Just by knowing that the, switch is up there. Wow, so that was interesting. Well, I'm interesting. Yeah, I remember the cheats. In fact, I remember all of that. That's still muscle memory. But I did not want to be defeated by my own level. Man, look how long it took me to actually play this level. So that was pretty much it for this stream, I think, in this broadcast. So I just learned some, and you guys tell me in the stream if I ever went down or if I was up the entire time. I was just trying to figure stuff out because I restarted the stream once. That would be something that's interesting to know. Thanks for just watching and asking questions and so on. That's good as well. So I'm thinking as we get into Tupa's Playground and then Memento Mori, you know, I'm going to do four levels or so. I'm going to go through them a little bit quicker than this level specifically here, but I think it's going to be fun. I'm definitely looking forward to it. So if somebody can tell me on the chat if I ever went out or not. My iPad is still trying to stream me back in. So, and in fact, I'm showing up over here, so that's interesting. Only went down to when I started. Okay, well, that's good to know. So I think there was just something going on with my wireless, because my computer is actually plugged into the network or something like that. Cool. So, thank you very much. I'm going to put this, in two parts on YouTube. That's cool as well. I don't know if you guys can hear this. Somebody's car alarm just went off outside, so I think that's a really good way to stop. And yeah, I'm gonna, so if you follow me on mvoich, at mvoich, the same as my handle here on Twitter, that's what I'm gonna announce when I'm streaming this stuff. I'm still trying to figure out exactly when to do it. I want to do it over the Christmas break at some point, but obviously there's gonna be a whole bunch of family stuff which takes precedence, so I'll figure out when I find some time, and you know, I'll try to definitely do my Doom levels, and we'll see how that goes. Didn't find all my secrets as I saw, so it's actually interesting. I don't even know which one I did not. I'm fine. But yeah, that's for a different stream. Thanks, guys, and I'll see you next time.